Welcome, welcome everyone. We're going to get started shortly, giving folks a few minutes to join us. If you've already joined us, we'd love to know who you are, where you're joining us from, and the role that you are playing in your organization. So if you could just share that in the chat. Welcome. We'll get started in a couple minutes. And we'll drop that in the chat. So just share your name, the organization you're with, where you're joining us from. Thank you, Dr. Ford. Thank you, Hannah. Welcome, welcome. If you're just joining us, please share your name, your org, where you're joining us from in the chat. And we'll get started in just a minute, just giving folks a chance to grab their lunches, get in front of their computer. My name is Laura McGowan Robinson. I lead the Diversity and Leadership Institute. So great to see you all here today. This is a community space. We want to get to know each other. So please share your name, your organization, and where you're joining us from in the chat. And if you feel so inclined, come off camera so we can see your face. But no pressure. Whatever makes you feel comfortable. Drop that in the chat just one more time. Hi, Terrell. Hi, Emma. Hi, Theo. Dr. Theo, excuse me. I see some old friends. Nice to see y'all. Hi, Angelica. All right. Feel free to continue to jam out to Janet Jackson. We're gonna turn it down a little bit and transition and get started with our program. Hi, Candace. Good to see you. Thank you all. Welcome, everyone. We're excited to kick this conversation off today. Good afternoon, students, parents, guardians, educators, and community members and advocates. We're so glad to have you join us today for this Charting the Course to Equity Coalition Lunch and Lead Community Action Call. As I shared earlier, my name is Dr. Laura McGowan Robinson. I'm the founder and CEO of Diversity and Leadership Institute, or DLI as we're also called. I'm also a proud member of the Charting the Course to Equity Coalition. We host Lunch and Lead calls on a monthly basis as a means to convene and activate community leaders from across the state around issues of cultural responsiveness, diversity, equity, inclusion, and public education. And each month, we feature new speakers, discussion topics, and action items. And today, we're here to highlight efforts to enhance Black educator recruitment and retention across California. And we're so excited to highlight LA Unified's progress of the 2022 resolution to prepare and retain Black educators 1 year after its passage. So I just want to give a quick shout out. I know we have folks from board member Ortiz Franklin's office joining us on the call today, our champion in carrying that resolution. We certainly want to thank her for her leadership and so many others who came to support that effort. In 2019, the Charting the Course to Equity Coalition was founded and facilitated by Diversity and Leadership Institute. It is a diverse and powerful network of 16 local and national organizations with a California presence that believe school leaders' racial diversity and cultural responsiveness skills are critical levers in creating successful schools. The function of the coalition, or as we call the CCEC, is to support and advance the mission of DLI through the development of key initiatives carried out by four major objectives. They are: contribute to and highlight research on the topic of racially diverse leadership in California, identify and amplify exemplary Black and Brown educators who've demonstrated success in closing the equity gap for students of color, to move from theory to action by seeking partnerships across the state to enhance existing educational leadership programs and preparing, supporting and retaining K through 12 school leaders of color. And lastly, to engage in collective advocacy to affect legislation and policies that impact Black and Brown students and educators. To get us started, I want to do a quick roll call of our partners, some of whom I know are here with us in the space today, and I want to shout you all out. So if you're here and you know I'm going to shout you out, you can jump, beat me to it and just share your name in the chat and the name of your organization. So Charting Course to Equity Coalition partners include Diversity and Leadership Institute. We have some folks from our team here. Feel free to drop in the chat. Loyola Marymount University School of Education, ACSA, the Association of California School Administrators, UNCF, Innovate Public Schools, CCSA, Teach for America Los Angeles, National Charter Collaborative, EdLock, Center for Powerful Public Schools, Education Trust West, Families in Action for Quality Schools Oakland, Black Educator Advocates Network, JLC Social Impact Consulting, and Educators for Excellence Los Angeles. So I will let those folks go ahead and join the waterfall of the Zoom chat and let us know you are here. These luncheon lead calls are for you and for all of us to engage and learn and leave equipped with information to act. So today, we invite you to do just that. We hope that today you leave with action steps to support diversifying the leadership pipeline and educator pipeline more broadly in California. We thank you for being with us today. We know you could be in a lot of different places enjoying your lunch. So we thank you for taking some time and enjoying your lunch with and having a great conversation with us today. So now I'd like all of you, if you haven't already, I've been seeing them roll in, but if you haven't had a chance already, please shout out your name, your city, the organization or school district that you're with in the chat. If you haven't done that, I'm seeing some of our partners who have already dropped that in. So good to see you here. We also invite you to engage on socials throughout this event by using the hashtag Lunch and Lead. If you aren't already, follow us on Twitter and also retweet about the Lunch and Lead using @DIL_Institute. That would be @DIL_Institute. Tell your friends and family members and colleagues to join the conversation. So I'm going to shift to talk a little bit about why we're here today. For far too long, the education system has faced a critical shortage of Black educators, with 9% of teachers in LAUSD identifying as Black in 2021 and 2022 school year. This lack of representation has been shown to have significant impacts on academic and social emotional development in our Black students. But there is hope. Today, we are excited to kick off this much needed conversation with a welcome video to address, from board member Tanya Ortiz Franklin, whose invaluable support and leadership helped us to pass the Black Student Excellence through Educator Diversity Preparation and Retention. So feel free to give a round of applause there, give us your emojis on your Zoom, and join us in listening to board member Ortiz Franklin's welcome address.
Hello, community leaders. I'm Tanya Ortiz Franklin, proud school board member for LA Unified Board District 7, and I'm so excited to be here with you today celebrating the one-year anniversary of our co-authored resolution, Black Student Excellence Through Educator Diversity, Preparation, and Retention. Thank you, DLI and the Charting the Course to Equity Coalition for bringing this issue to our office and for constantly challenging us to do better by our Black students, our Black staff members, and our Black families. You all know why this resolution is important and why we must do better by Black students, but let me just remind you that in Los Angeles Unified, the second largest district in the entire country, only 46% of our Black students last year were eligible for public universities in the state of California. Just saying that out loud reminds us that we have to do better. Every kid should get to choose college. And that doesn't just start in high school. On average, our Black students in third grade literacy and mathematics across the grade levels are twice as far away from proficiency as the average district student. That's not okay. We must do better. And thanks to our coalition partners, we absolutely are focused on getting it right. So what have we done in this year since the resolution? Well, first we looked at the data. We knew some of the student data, but we didn't know all of the adult data. Some of what we've learned has challenged us. For example, every year in Los Angeles Unified, we lose about 100 Black educators every single year. We now know that about 2,000 Black students in LA Unified do not have a Black educator on their campus. Most of them are in elementary school, and we want to fix that. Now, across the district, we are about proportionate, 9% Black students and educators, and yet, we think it's still not okay that a student would go their entire TK through 12 experience, never having had not just one Black educator, but many, normalizing it, normalizing having access to diverse educators, which represent the entire city of Los Angeles. So we're working on that, and the resolution has called for us to pay better attention to some of these data points. Some of the ways that we've done that are by creating an Office of Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion in our HR team. And so we have staff members focused on recruiting folks from HBCUs, making sure they feel welcomed on their campus and will stay with us for as long as possible. Sometimes just knowing about what the issue is can really help address some of the challenges. We have twice the number of Black educators in our district intern program than there are Black educators training across the state of California. That tells us that our growing our own program is working, and we just got to hang on to those folks as well. But this is just a start. You know, fulfilling the promise of this resolution is absolutely about making sure all of the Black educators who are in our system, who come to our system, feel safe, supported, prepared, and like they're doing a good job for Black students and for all students across the district. But ultimately, it's about our kids. It's about every Black child being fully prepared for college, career, and life. It's about every child across Los Angeles Unified having access to high quality instruction. And this resolution is just one piece of the puzzle that's gonna get us there. So thank you for your leadership, and thank you for continuing to hold us to the fire on what we've promised.
Thank you so much, Board Member Tanya Ortiz Franklin, for sharing that important information and for sharing the progress that we made and acknowledging that we still have a ways to go. And thank you for your leadership and commitment on this issue. Next, I will be transitioning to our panel discussion. And we'll hear from people in the field, including Dr. Violet Ford, who is a researcher from the Learning Accelerator, and Dr. Robert Whitman, the newly appointed Education Transformation Officer in LAUSD. Next, we'll hear from them about how they're addressing the need to recruit, sustain, and prepare Black educators. We reached out to these individuals because they represent a wide range of experience and expertise, both in research and on the ground in building intentional learning environments that support, develop, and organize the increase of Black educators in California schools and locally. These two educators and leaders will share their insight and vision for why they prioritize Black educators in schools and provide context on some of the challenges we face. During the conversation, I'm going to invite you to comment, to share your thoughts, to have your questions ready, because there will be a Q&A. And they are going to share, we're going to hear directly from them and have them provide their own introductions. But I'll give a little bit of a tidbit about who they are before we get started. Dr. Violet Ford is an associate partner research and measurement at the Learning Accelerator. Her portfolio of work in education includes examining equitable learning spaces and connections to collaboration, leadership, and community engagement. She is most passionate about supporting leaders and practitioners to implement innovative and effective learning systems for all students. Dr. Ford has a multifaceted professional portfolio in research, continuous improvement, and program operations. She lives in Oklahoma with her husband and 5 children. I'm going to invite her to join me in this virtual space. Then we have Dr. Robert Whitman. He's been an educator in the Los Angeles Unified School District for 20 years. During his career at LAUSD, he served as a teacher, dean of students, assistant principal, principal, central office administrator, community of schools administrator, also known as COSA, and educational transformation officer. And he's been in that role for about 2 weeks now. And congratulations to him. Through each of these experiences, he's acquired expertise in several areas of education. For example, curriculum and instruction, special education, college readiness, and the list goes on, that have enabled him to become a strong advocate for underserved student populations. Throughout his career, he's maintained a philosophy of leaving it better than he found it, an attitude that inspires him to embrace challenges and take pride in his work. As a product of public schools, he remains steadfast in his belief that all students can learn and has firsthand experience as a student and educator that responsive public schools empower students to recognize their immeasurable potential. He recognizes that the continuous nature of school reform and upholds a reflective attitude that enables him to remain committed to educating all students. Please join me also in welcoming Dr. Robert Whitman. We'll invite him to the space. All right, so while we are transitioning him to the screen, we'll start with you, Dr. Ford, and we're going to give you the floor to share a little bit about your work. I'm going to step off the screen for a moment, and then we are looking forward to hearing from you and about your work.
Good afternoon, everyone. First, I want to thank you all for inviting me to participate in today's Lunch and Lead event. Just reviewing the work that you all are doing, I just wanted to pause and take my hat off and say that I want to honor all of the work that is being done and your dedication to improving equity in education. So yes, I am Violet Ford, associate partner in research and measurement at the Learning Accelerator. We're a national nonprofit where we are working to advance an equitable vision for learning. We also seek to bridge knowledge and wisdom to the sector and catalyze collective action and change. We're focused on equity in that we're a very learner-centered organization, and we believe learning should be personalized, that's unique to each individual child, so that they can receive an effective, engaging, and equitable education. My own background in research and education is in the education nonprofit K-12 space. So prior to joining TLA, my experience was focused on after school or out of school time career readiness preparation for students experiencing poverty. And so most relevant to today's discussion, I'm looking forward to sharing our research with Lindsay Unified School District, where we conducted a mixed method study to examine the first year impacts of their Grow Your Own residency program.
Thank you so much, Dr. Ford. I appreciate you sharing a little bit about your background. I'm looking forward to digging in a little bit more. Dr. Whitman should be joining us shortly, but until then, I'm going to jump in on the screen with you and we'll have a little bit of a dialogue between the two of us. So I'm really interested in learning more about the work that you've done and your team have done around teacher residency programs. And what we know about teacher residency programs is that they have the potential to address two systems level challenges, which we've seen exacerbated by the pandemic. Educator shortages being one of them, and then the second being training for novice educators. So given the current teacher shortages and the need to prepare educators for the unique contexts of their communities, districts, and have increasingly turned to, they've increasingly turned to grow your own models, which we hear a lot about. And we see actually happening here locally and written about pretty broadly. And according to recent research from the National Center for Teacher Residencies, afford unique benefits. So could you provide an overview of the findings of that mixed methods study that you did and your team did to understand the impacts of the first year of that within Lindsay Unified School District's Grow Your Own Residency Program?
Yes, absolutely. Is it okay if I share my screen from this point?
Absolutely.
Okay. Give me one second. You know, I'm trying to move windows around here.
No problem. We all get it.
Okay. Can you see that okay? All righty. So first I will begin by giving just a little quick overview of Lindsay's Grow Your Own Residency Program. Lindsay Unified School District is deeply focused on personalized learning in their performance-based system. They had two goals for the residency program. They sought to develop novice teachers who could learn and adopt the district's shared language and practices centered on personalized learning. And they also had a deep desire to recruit and retain teachers in the district who understood the lived experiences of students. A little bit of background on the district, as some of you are probably aware, but they're located in the Central Valley of California, where the learner population comes from a rural, largely Hispanic, Latine, low-income community. There's a substantial percentage of learners in the district that are classified as English learner or receiving migrant and homeless services. The district shared a report with TLA that indicated that less than half of the surrounding community has earned more than a high school diploma. And so it was important to the district to build an educator pipeline that could be a role model for students who had attained a higher level of education while contributing to the overall development of that community. So our role with Lindsay Unified School District was as a research partner. We conducted a mixed method study to understand the value that the residency partners, Alder GSC and Marshall Teacher Residency, brought to their co-design process, ways that the residents' pedagogy was impacted, as well as their knowledge and ability to implement the district's performance-based system. We also wanted to know ways in which the residency program provided supports for residents. And finally, we examined the impacts of having a resident in the classroom on student learning. So looking at their partnerships, we gathered data through a focus group with LUSD school leaders who were responsible for the residency program, which included one principal and two program coordinators. We wanted to understand how the partnerships brought value to the development of their residency program. The leaders were very candid about the benefits of the program co-design process. They felt that their partners contributed a plethora of resources and brought a vast amount of teacher residency program design experience. The leaders also shared that the program partners helped provide coherence with the district's innovative hiring model while honoring the district's unique district language. And also the district really wanted to maintain control of the resident placement and hiring process, and their partners were very key in that process. In addition, their partners provided training resources, facilitation, and program course evaluations. The district really looked at their partners as a means for a strong collaboration and thought partnership. And they felt that the way that the program was designed, it was fully aligned to their values as a district. So thinking again about the goals of the residency program, we know that the district wanted to provide training for novice teachers to prepare them for their performance-based system. And so through survey responses, we found that residents felt fairly confident to completely confident that their level of instructional preparedness could demonstrate personalized learning. And so I won't read all of the skill areas here, but some of the skills that the residents felt confident in were demonstrating high expectations for learner achievement and customizing learning to each individual student. And so instructional preparedness with a very rigorous coursework in real-world learning were essential elements for preparing residents. We also found that residents benefited from a training environment with high expectations and high-level support. Residents reported that they felt supported by their teacher mentors and their program coordinators. They actually attributed their instructional preparedness to strong relationships with their mentors, the coaching process, constructive feedback, and also collaboration. So thinking about recruitment, which we know is a large focus of our discussion today, LUSD intentionally sought residents from within their surrounding community. One leader shared with us during the focus group that there is an idea that the district has an imperative to shift the poverty statistics in the community. So recruiting from the community brought a dual value. One, that educators who understood the lived experiences of learners, an opportunity to elevate the labor market in the district's surrounding community. When one leader shared that, they said, "We are fostering the middle class in the community. The school district is the largest employer in Lindsay. And so with learners going off to college and then coming home to serve their community, this becomes a cog to give kids a pipeline back to the community." They recruited 15 residents from the areas surrounding their district. And the residents entered with varying educational backgrounds. Some of them had previously been employed through the district, such as like an instructional aide or after school leaders. And some of them had actually graduated from Lindsay Unified School District. So they were very aware of their performance-based system. They had connections and they had roots within the district. Further, the district really focused on diversifying their pipeline of educators in that the participants or the residents were predominantly of color. They were first-gen college graduates and from high poverty backgrounds. In addition to the district's commitment to developing novice educators, they also developed their current teachers. Teacher mentors were responsible for real-world learning with residents through a co-teaching process. They also provided coaching and feedback for residents and assisted them with instructional planning and preparation. During a focus group, one of the leaders shared that one of the mentors shared with them that they had previously worked with traditional student teachers, but through the residency program, they saw differences in their own professional growth due to the development training that they received as mentors and also just that piece of accountability in working with the residents. And then finally, we looked at impacts on student learning. We spoke with sixth grade students, which was really interesting, in a focus group. And we wanted to know what their thoughts were on having two teachers in the classroom. And the students shared that they enjoy having two educators in the classroom, particularly with the continuum of instruction that occurs when, for example, one teacher has to step out of the room or when they are working in small groups. Additionally, they felt like it benefited them to be able to ask their teachers different perspectives on life experiences, but also questions related to math concepts that they found were difficult. Some students also share that they felt a greater sense of motivation, connection, and belongingness that they had with having two teachers in the classroom. And so those are, that's just kind of a quick overview of the findings that we found with our study at Lindsay Unified School District.
Thank you for sharing, Dr. Ford. Appreciate your research and that of the team. I'm also going to tee up if folks who are listening have questions for Dr. Ford, if you want to drop those in the chat, we'd love to hear from you. There's already a question there about where folks could access the research, Dr. Ford. Where might they find this? And then, of course, after you share verbally, if you want to drop something in the chat, feel free.
Yes, I'm actually going to tee that up now on our website. Our website is learningaccelerator.org, but I will put the link for the report in the chat.
Thank you for that. I want to express just my deep appreciation for this research, and part of this work, as we know, is not keeping it to ourselves, but making sure that we're spreading it widely so that it can be replicated. One of the questions that comes to mind for me as I'm hearing about the pipeline, and I'm definitely seeing opportunities as I'm thinking about here locally with LA Unified and the Black Student Achievement Plan, pipelines for students who might be interested in becoming educators. And I see the opportunity was really harnessed in the work with Lindsay Unified. My question is around, you know, what are the funds? How are folks accessing funds to go through these residency programs? Who's funding the residency program? How did that work out? And what learnings came forward around that, especially folks who might have been first generation college students, right? So how are we finding opportunities to ensure they aren't bringing on student loan debt, period? How about that?
Yes, absolutely. So the residency program at Lindsay Unified School District was grant funded. And so the participants did not have to pay for that training. They engaged in rigorous coursework first, and then they spent time in that experiential learning co-teaching space for some months with their mentor teacher. They were also provided stipends as they participated in the program. So they did not have to pay for the costs of the program. And then they were also provided with living stipends.
Wow. And could you, for folks who might not know, where geographically, where is Lindsay Unified located in the state?
So Central Valley, California, and I've actually never been there. The research was started before I came on board. So some of my TLA members were there to do a site visit with them and everything, but Central Valley, that's the most that I know.
Thank you for that, Dr. Ford. There's a follow-up, and I asked because, you know, in Los Angeles, and I was just talking about this with Dr. Whitman today, just the cost of living in Los Angeles in comparison to the teacher salary can be prohibitive, right? So thank you, Paula, for giving me a geography lesson. Absolutely, thank you. Now I can get my bearings about where Lindsay Unified is. But yeah, that is a question, right? So if I wanna live in Los Angeles, what is the cost of living? And then what am I being paid as a teacher? And I think this is a good opportunity to bring Dr. Whitman into the conversation and just to share a little bit about the work happening in LA Unified around the Black Students Excellence through Educator Diversity Preparation and Recruitment Resolution, also being called the Black Educator Resolution. If you could give us a bit of an update, what steps are being taken to recruit and retain educators from other underrepresented groups, but particularly for Black educators?
All right, Dr. McCown, thank you for inviting me and allowing me to share some of the work that's happening in LA Unified right now as it relates to this topic. The district it continues to position itself as an employer of choice and offers a competitive comprehensive benefits package to its employees. We recently received a commitment from our now superintendent, Alberto Carvalho, that he wants to ensure that our district continues to be able to offer such package and even be recognized on the national level, for the benefits that it's providing its employees. And I think that's very critical given right now the cost of living in Los Angeles is ridiculous. It's very, very, very challenging for everybody, including myself, to be quite frank with you. And I know that as a new teacher, just putting myself back in, dating myself 23 years ago or 24 years ago, just starting off, it's, and just being in that space now, that would be very difficult for me or anyone to manage. The district offers programs that allow aspiring teachers to get their teaching credential. We do have an intern credentialing and added authorization program. And our team in HR are very aggressive in recruitment, but also identifying good substitute teachers whom we can put on a pathway to becoming a teacher. And they've done a really good job right now with that, given the fact that, they're just not enough qualified professionals in the field. Once individuals receive their, whether it's their teacher credentials or their admin credentials, we also have tier two or other authorization programs within our district to help them clear those administrative credentials. We have a robust career ladder program for those individuals who are paraprofessionals right now, or in any for all classified staff members who aspire to become either a teacher or a nurse or what have you. And we've done really good work in terms of helping some of our classified staff members to become certificated. Particularly African American American males in particular, just thinking about some of the folks who have recently gone from educators to now special education teachers. We work with more than, we work with at least seven universities, local universities nearby, the four CSUs, LA, Dominguez Hills, Northridge, as well as Long Beach, as well as UCLA, USC, and LMU, all which, serve a diverse student population in terms of recruitment. I shared this earlier with Laura and team that this time last year, we still got a lot of work to do in terms of recruitment of Black educators, but we're a little bit ahead this year than where we were last year. Not by a lot, but we are moving in the right direction nonetheless. The district currently operates, six grants funded residency programs in our local universities to allow candidates to enter the profession through a rigorous year-long apprenticeship without the burden of the full cost of attendance of such a program. And we also have affinity groups within our district right now. We have one for Black males educators, which I'm a part of that. And we mentor, those who are teachers and who are aspiring administrators. The goal is to develop a very similar concept and program for our African-American women here in our district to, help guide, groom, and shape them to become future administrators. And I've shared this earlier. Some of you are aware that, for those teachers who are working in some of our most underserved schools, or what we call high city schools in LA Unified, there's a $5,000 stipend that's given to them as they're entering into the profession as an added bonus or incentive to for them to work in our schools. And so there's quite a bit happening, with regards to recruitment and retention. There's a lot of work that needs to be done. Part of the conversation that we had earlier is really around retention too. It's like, how do we, retain, Black educators within our system? How do we work with our school site leaders to create the conditions for one to want to remain? And we know that the new generation of teachers who are coming into the profession right now, if they're not happy, they're very quick to walk away from it. They're not, committed to a 25 or 30 year career in a space where they don't feel welcome or they don't feel supported. And so, like, how do we create settings within our schools so that we're fostering teacher collaboration, and how do we honor the voices of our teachers and that they and develop that trust and respecting with relationships that we want, you know, all of our teachers to have with administrators within our systems, because we know those are our best practices that eventually benefit our students or what have you. And so we, you know, there's a lot of things that are going on and that we're making, and we're very proud about the progress that we're making. But, you know, we still have a lot of work to do nonetheless. And there are a lot of challenges or what have you that we're working to overcome.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Whitman, for that overview and sharing kind of the status of where we are within LA Unified and kind of where we want to go. And as you were speaking, there were some questions that were coming in through the chat, and I just want to encourage those who are part of our audience, if you have questions, feel free to drop them in, and we certainly want to bring those forward. I wanted to loop back to a follow-up question that Board Member Ortiz Franklin had around the research that you shared, Dr. Ford. And also feel free, Board Member Ortiz, if you want to come off mute and share your question aloud, we'd also love to hear your voice if that's a possibility for you right now. I'll pause. If not, then I'll go ahead and read your question. All right, I'll go ahead and read it. So the follow-up was based on the question that I asked before about the cost associated with the residency program, which I'm happy to hear that there was none and that folks could be able to participate in those programs without incurring student loan debt. The follow-up was how the cost compares to recruiting a teacher or filling vacancies, which she hears is an average of $20,000 per teacher. So I'm guessing opposed to kind of recruiting a teacher from the market, if you will, how does this cost compare going through a residency program?
That is a really great question. And I'll be honest, I'm not prepared to answer that question because I didn't, you know, that wasn't anything that we covered in our research. Sorry about that.
No worries. It's a great question. We'll put a pin in it. And if Dr. Whitman may have an idea, feel free to chime in. If not, we'll roll to our other question and come back to our audience, hopefully in the future with one around that. Did you have anything to add, Dr. Whitman?
You know what? I don't. However, I'll be prepared to be able to respond to that. I'll connect with Jacob Guthrie, you know, who's boots on the ground in HR, who's very adept in that area to be able to give us a response to that. But I think it's a good question nonetheless.
Wonderful. Congratulations, Board Member Ortiz Franklin. She has a little baby with her right now, so she's not able to verbalize her question, but we were able to get it out there. And thank you, Dr. Whitman, for offering to follow up with that question. There was another question about non-classroom opportunities for educators of color, particularly for instructional coaching or SEL coaching. Dr. Whitman, what can you share with us about what's happening in LA Unified, if you are aware, with non-classroom opportunities? And one thing I do want to lift up that came out of the internal analysis unit report on Black educators within the district was that LA Unified is leading when it comes to representation of Black administrators across the county. And there's a lot to be, and essentially probably across the state, there's a lot to be learned in terms of leadership opportunities for Black educators in the district who are interested in maybe site principalship or going into additional, maybe central office administrator roles. So even outside of administrator roles or opportunities, what can you share about non-classroom based opportunities for Black educators?
Yes, so, you know, that varies, you know, across different regions of our district. However, we do have a significant number, and I don't have the data offhand, but when you think about Region South, for example, that's a area where I'm most familiar. You'll find that there are a significant number of, you know, African Americans who are actually serving in, you know, non-classroom positions, whether they're a coordinator or ELA or math coordinator or instructional coach. Perhaps they're an RJ teacher or some type of interventionist or what have you. We see a significant number of those individuals serving in those roles. You know, the district is leading in many ways as it relates to diversity and at the administrative level or what have you. And Laura, you and I talked about this earlier. You know, this work is very timely because thinking about what that demographic looks like 5 or 10 years from now, given the fact that we do have a dearth of African Americans going into the field of education, it's very, you know, interesting to see what that will look like, you know, given that, you know, we have people retiring and, you know, a lot of different transitioning or what have you that's happening within our district. I'm also just want to share that, and thanks to this resolution and this, the work, that internal work that's happening within our system, you know, we when I look around and I sit in the senior leadership meetings now within my new role, but it's refreshing to see that when I look to the right and the left, that I see a Black woman who's a region superintendent within our district, and also a Black male who's also a region superintendent. And so being able to see that level of diversity in LA Unified, which is something that we haven't seen in either in recent history or what have you, or ever, is really refreshing. And to know that the individuals are very committed to the work and you know, accelerating and achievement for our kids as a whole in the district. And so I'm very, you know, refreshed to see that we're actually moving in the right direction as a system.
Thank you for that. And thank you. It's good to hear we're a little bit past a year since the resolution was passed, but some of the real tangible shifts that we're seeing in terms of personnel, that's really encouraging to hear. We are coming up on the end of our time, but I did want to pose another question to you, Dr. Whitman. I know that a lot of the work that's been done around the resolution and the implementation of it came from focus groups that were held within the district. And I know that DLI also, and with the support of the coalition, also held focus groups as well. And I'm curious to hear some of the themes that emerged from those focus groups, and what were some of the opportunities or challenges faced by Black educators in LAUSD? And then given the plan that you all have, how are you addressing those challenges or opportunities?
Yes, so I wasn't a part of the particular focus groups that took place in the district at the time. However, I will share that the district is committed to ensuring that there's diversity within our system. We have a new office within HR where that administrator will be focusing on diversity efforts at all levels of our system, whether it's at the classroom level, the out of classroom level at our schools, middle manager level, whether we're talking about region directors here in the central office, et cetera. And so there is an office within our district now that's committed to focusing in on those particular needs within our system. That office right now is being led by Dr. Adana Brown. And I would love to be able to invite her into this space where she can actually share a little bit more in terms of the efforts that are underway to do that. You know, Ileana Davalos, who's our chief human resources officer, she speaks specific in terms of the action steps that our district is taking right now, and they're meaningful action steps. And it's not only just things that we share with you, you can actually see it around us. You know, we see that, we are, moving the needle in certain areas. When we look at the number of Black educators right now who are in teacher education programs, whether within our system or, around us or what have you, LA Unified has had a big influence in terms of those numbers and helping, Black and those of color, others in color of color to be in, to be on the pathway to become teachers. And so there are a lot of good action steps that are taking place, a lot of good systems and And I would look forward to having Dr. Dana Brown come in and speak to the new office that's within HR, where she can shed a little bit more light in terms of, you know, what's to come in terms of accelerating where we are right now in our system, sustaining and accelerating.
Thank you so much, Dr. Whitman. I will give, if either one of you would like to share any closing comments about this work, any final thoughts, or anything that is around how we might continue to move forward, how do we continue this momentum? I'll yield the floor to you first, Dr. Ford, and then to you, Dr. Whitman, if you'd like to share any closing comments to close us out for today.
First, I'll just say thank you again for inviting me today. I think one final thought is just to emphasize what has already been said about the importance of having Black educators in the K-12 space. We know that when we have Black educators in the space, Black students and white students benefit from having Black educators in this space from a sense of being able to promote diversity and the dignity of students, honoring the full potential and uniqueness of all students. And so we know that we have a lot of work to do as far as continuing to recruit more diverse teachers into the pipeline. And so I think that's about it. Thank you again for having me.
Thank you, Dr. Ford. Dr. Whitman?
Yes, thank you, Dr. McCrown. And I appreciate the opportunity to be here to speak to everybody. Someone once told me this, and this is a phrase that I'm sure is familiar with all of you. If you're not at the table, you're on the menu. And so when you think about representation, it matters. You know, and the reason why we made strides within our district as it relates to, you know, Black educator representation, you know, the Black student achievement plan is the fact that we've actually had, you know, either their board members or leaders within our system who are sitting at the table, who are actually having conversations and who are advocating for this work. You know, my hat goes off to Dr. Jared Dupree. Most of you know him. He's a senior leader within our system. And for a while, he was probably the only African-American at a senior level in our system, but he's done a phenomenal job with pushing that work forward to now in our system. We actually have a student achievement plan, which is something that we've never had before, with money investments there. And then there's other leaders within our system who are really, you know, pushing the initiative. And we know that this is very important because, as I shared before, when you see the dearth of Black educators that are getting in the right now, the trajectory is not where we want it to be. And that's going to have implications, you know, down the road as it relates to representation and perhaps even resources, Black achievement, you know, things of that nature. And so having this forum, having this dialogue, us coming together to share ideas around this very important topic, I think is critical. And it's something that we need to continue so that we can continue, you know, moving in the direction in which we believe we need to move in. And I also just wanted to take a moment as well, like as we are continuing to, you know, discuss this topic, but also to celebrate the growth, even if they're small wins, right? You know, celebrate those wins, because I think that's very important, you know, as we continue to move on. And I try to remind my team of that as well, because sometimes we get frustrated or we don't see things that we hope to see. But we do want to make sure that we're celebrating the small wins as well as we move along in the direction in which we need to continue to move. I see a lot of, you know, other organizations that in our community right now who are, you know, doing this work. They're, you know, creating the space where, you know, future educators can come in and cultivating them so that they can actually come into our system. There's a lot of momentum, a lot of inertia happening right now. And so, you know, I just feel like we just need to continue to come together, you know, press the system, press individuals like me that work inside the system, but at the same time, also celebrate the growth that that we're making as well around this particular topic.
Thank you. And thank you both for your work, your continued work on this very, very important issue. And looking forward to seeing even more work from the both of you as we continue to move forward on ensuring that we are preparing, recruiting, and retaining Black educators. And with that, I will turn it over to Saray Addison, our public policy fellow.
Thank you, Laura. Thank you both, Dr. Ford and Dr. Whitman, for joining us today, as well as this thought-provoking conversation. Both of you all have brought forth quite a lot of information that we can all take action on in our schools and ask the right questions to continue to push this work forward. Right now, I'm going to invite one of our coalition members, Hannah Gravett. She's the regional VP of Innovate Public Schools in Los Angeles. She's going to share with us how we can take action now. Join me in welcoming Hannah Gravett.
Hello, hello, everybody. We've got a few minutes left here, so please hang with us because we've got some quick, easy, but important next steps we want you to take before you log off from the hour. So today we discussed how the different types of research that supports the impact of programs that intentionally focus on growing the Black educator workforce. And then we also got to hear from a couple districts and individuals where some places where we really are doing the work and creating solutions that put this evidence into practice. But all of us at the coalition, I think all of you on this call know that we don't want the work to just end there and that we actually want to see an investment in leaders in color, not only in Los Angeles, but across the state. And so today we also want to invite you all to join us in a statewide campaign that endeavors to do just that, to actually get some resources, identify some resources to invest in these types of initiatives. So the Diversity and Leadership Institute, alongside educators, parents, students, and partners statewide, have launched the Diverse Education Leaders Pipeline Initiative. And what this initiative will do is that it calls on the governor, this California governor, and our state legislature to invest $18 million of state dollars towards the training, credentialing, and placement of 300 new TK through 12 leaders of color in California over the next 3 to 5 years. So again, we're inviting you to join our campaign, our initiative, which is asking the governor and the state to invest $18 million to identify and support leaders of color that will get placed into new positions in California over the next 3 to 5 years. So in order to do this, we really need your help to get this initiative front and center in the attention of our lawmakers in Sacramento. In order to do that, we would love for all of you, before you leave the call today, to sign our change.org petition. So we just put a link in the chat. So please, if you've been standing or stretching, like make your way back to your computer, click on that link, and please take 1 minute to sign on to this change.org petition, asking the governor, and the message will go to the governor and all of our legislators, asking them, impressing on them the importance of investing these $18 million in this initiative. Thank you.
Awesome. Thank everyone for taking action. This is assuming that everybody signs up to the link from the change.org. Your partnership is truly invaluable. Next, we will hear from student who believes Black educators matter, make a significant impact in the lives of Black students.
The volume is not on.
Raise your hand if you have had a Black African-American educator at any point in your school experience. Okay. See everyone besides prayer. Okay, so you can put your hands down. Thank you. What's your experience like with your Black educator?
I know for me, most of my teachers and educators are at my school are Black and brown. And so I always feel welcome, and I always feel that the teachers are understanding. And they also serve as role models, because a lot of the teachers in my school, they also went to the same high school as me. They went to college, and then they came back to serve. And that's how they serve as role models. And they're very understanding. They've lived in the community where I live, and they know what responsibilities many students hold.
Those these two Black educators on campus, both female, and I've never had the class, but we are on first name basis. So even though I've never sat down in the class, they've never taught me anything, you know, from a textbook, I still have such a strong connection with both of them because they look like me, and they'll just like, they treat me like with respect, which most teachers do, but it's just that fulfillingness of being able to see myself in them. I think they see themselves in me. So just being able to form that connection.
Thank you, Saray, for sharing that video. I think it's really powerful. It was really cool to be a part of that conversation and to center student voices. We are wrapping up now, and we want to thank all of our presenters for the insights you shared, and all of our attendees for your really good questions. We hope that you're leaving informed, energized, and equipped with the tools you need to make schools more equitable and led by leaders who are culturally responsive and reject anti-Blackness. I also want to send a special thank you to the Charting the Course to Equity Coalition and all of the participants in our third Lunch and Leap community call. Finally, to stay in the loop about the work of DLI and the coalition, we ask that you follow us on our socials, sign up for our newsletter, or you can always visit our website at www.diversityinleadership.org. As a reminder, if you registered for this event, you'll receive a follow-up email with a survey. So we'll ask you to fill that out. And we'll be sending clips from today's Zoom call that you can share on your socials. So have a great afternoon, stay safe, and keep fighting for the schools you deserve. Thank you, everybody.